This is one of the most beautiful things that was ever built.
Well, I think typically, like most folks, you have to have a connection to it, whether it be a family member or a friend or whatever. And for me, it was my father and of course, my brother as well. He was involved. My dad had been a pilot back in the 60s and had a little cub and used to take my older two brothers flying. And then he bought a Stearman with another gentleman down in the Houston area. And we had that airplane for probably 10, 12 years. And that was right whenever I was growing up, and, you know, from like 6, 7 years old up through high school. And a lot of my first flying memories are in the Stearman. My first involvement with the B-17 and other warbirds with the Flight Museum began in 1993, 1994, somewhere around there. My older brother had become a member at the museum, was taking down a Stearman that my dad had restored, flew that down there a little bit and started flying a couple of the museum airplanes, and I joined around 93, 94 as a volunteer. Started organizing some of the air shows and helping with that. And then when the president retired, I took over, and I think it was 2006. Well, the main goals of the museum are obviously to preserve a vital part of our nation's history and to allow that as a vehicle to capture kids' imagination, to have a little perspective of what these airplanes did and why they're important. The B-17 was developed in the late 1930s. It was one of America's first four-engine bombers. It won the contract from the government. They started building them, set a lot of records in the first early operation of the airplane. And of course, as the war progressed, more orders came in for the airplane. It went through several different changes and modifications, obviously, with each model. Just like any other aircraft. Obviously, by the time the G's were rolling out, they were far more capable than the early versions of the B-17. Its main use was obviously as a heavy bomber, and it served mainly in the European theater. There were some in the Pacific, but by far the vast majority were deployed in the European theater of operations. Roughly 13,000 built, a little under. And today, roughly 13 are flyable at this time.
Cirrus Designs Vision SJ50 single-engine personal jet offers exceptional fuel efficiency, flexible seating for up to 7, advanced avionics, and all the Cirrus safety features you expect, including the Cirrus airframe parachute system. With its V-tail design, the Cirrus Vision is technologically advanced, yet engineered to be simple to fly, to allow owner pilots more lifestyle pursuits than any other personal aircraft. Learn more about the Vision SJ50 at cirrusdesign.com.
Thunderbird rolled off the assembly line on May 8, 1945, which was the day the war ended in Europe. So it never saw actual combat. It sat at several depot fields here in the U.S. awaiting its fate with the scrapper. But it, along with a few other B-17s, were purchased by a geographic company in France. And it was used from the late 40s into the late 70s as a high-altitude topographer. It had a lot of cameras and other remote sensing type equipment in it, and it flew all across Europe, Africa, South America. It was even registered in South Africa for several years. We have some pictures of it in Algiers and a few other places. So it lived a relatively easy life after the war, meaning that it had a stable payload. It was well maintained. It wasn't used as a fire bomber or a insecticide bomber or anything else that they had that could have caused excessive corrosion. So all in all, it was in fairly decent shape whenever we purchased the airplane in 1987. They had already reassembled it and gone through the airplane a little bit. By far, you know, when we came to Houston, it pretty much had a thorough restoration, pretty much to the configuration you see today. It's typical wartime configuration. They typically had a crew of 10. You had two men in the nose, the bombardier and the navigator, of course the pilot and the co-pilot, and the flight engineer, top turret gunner. You had the radio operator just behind the bomb bay in the crew compartment there. Then you had the two waist gunners and the tail gunner. So it had roughly 13 guns. He had four in the nose, two in the top turret, two in the ball turret. I left out the ball turret gunner, can't forget about him. Two in the ball turret, one in the radio room, and one on each side of the airplane in the waist, and then two in the tail.
Okay, we are cleared for our approach. Have our Garmin GPS set up to fly the LPV. And look, here comes the glide path. You're probably wondering how we can intercept a glide path when there's no ILS on the field. Well, hey, that's the beauty of WASS GPS. No ILS, no localizer, no problem. WASS gives us full vertical guidance even without ground-based nav aids. Okay, next, you're probably wondering why there's spit all over your side of the windshield.
Flying the B-17 is, it's obviously any person's dream, I would think. If you're into aviation and you see this airplane, you know that it's something special. It's obviously a big thrill. The neat thing about it, if you come from a light twin or whatever background, just a regular general aviation airplane, you look out the right window and there's two big engines and a lot of wing, and you look out the left and it's the same thing over there, and you're going, wow, how am I going to do this? But it behaves fairly predictably. There's not a lot of gotchas in it. If you're doing everything right, it's a little slow to respond, so you want to make sure that it's doing what you want it to do. From starting it up, you know, you feel the rumble and the shake of the engines as they come to life. Then you start the remaining three and you get them all going and you're set, letting it warm up and going through your checklist and everything else, and it's quite a thrill. And then once you start taxi it just like any other normal tail dragger. You don't have to S-turn because you can see out the cockpit. So you're not blind like you would be in a Cub or a T6 or any other tail dragger. Go through all your pre-flight, get it ready to go, your run-up checks, get on the runway, lock the tail wheel, and then walk up the four throttles. And by the time you're getting about 70, 80 miles an hour, she's starting to think about wanting to fly. About 100, you're definitely up in the air, just broke ground. It'll generally fly itself off. You don't have to yank it off the ground or anything. It'll fly itself off when she's good and ready. You smell a little bit of rubber whenever the wheels get up into the wells against the stoppers, and it's just a wonderful experience. It's a little heavy on the ailerons. A lot of people are surprised at just how much Armstrong it takes to move it around with the ailerons. Pretty sensitive in pitch, and you have very good rudder control, but just like any big airplane, as you're cruising on a cross country or something, it'll tend to waller a little bit. You just got to keep it going straight, and it's nothing that's annoying or anything else. It's just a little characteristic of it, but it's a joy to fly, and the neat thing is being able to share it with others, and not only on the ground, people seeing the airplane, but on our flight experiences and everything else. It's pretty neat to see the expression on people's faces when they get out of the airplane. It's the same one that I have on mine every time, but it's pretty neat.